If you're still under the impression that fat is the great evil that lurks within the diets of highly developed nations, you have got to liberate yourself. To the extent that there is one great evil, it's probably simple carbohydrates, not fats. And any notion to the contrary that you still have hanging out in your head is in part the result of a deliberate disinformation campaign that was propagated by the American sugar industry in the 1960s and 70s. According to a 2016 analysis of historical documents published in the Journal of the American Medical Association, sugar trade groups paid scientists to produce research that shifted the blame for heart disease from sugar to fats. In the ensuing decades, U.S. health authorities and other experts promoted a low-fat, high-carb diet, thus ushering in what Dr. David Ludwig of Harvard Medical School calls arguably the largest public health experiment in history. He also calls it a massive public health failure because, quote, "Throughout the ensuing 40 years, the prevalence of obesity and diabetes increased several fold, even as the proportion of fat in the U.S. diet decreased by 25%. The low-fat, high-carb philosophy that was bought and paid for by sugar barons made us sicker and fatter." Now, among the people who have already liberated themselves from this industry propaganda, I think a new mythology is taking hold. There's nothing bad about fats. Saturated, unsaturated, they're all good for you and you should eat as much as you want. Yes, fats can be good for you, certain fats in particular, but as Barry White said, too much of anything is not good for you, baby. And the science exonerating saturated fat is not nearly as settled as some people believe. And there is at least one form of fat that you probably shouldn't eat ever. Want details? Field trip to the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, where Dr. Raz Shaikh does research on dietary fats, particularly as they relate to obesity and diabetes.
Certainly, I think we all agree on in the field that consuming more omega-3 fat, which comes from marine sources, fish oils, is beneficial or has potential beneficial effects.
Benefits for brain development, for example. Dr. Shaikh says that much is essentially settled science. Potential benefits would include lowering inflammation among obese people. Inflammation can cause all kinds of problems, including diabetes. Dr. Shaikh, in fact, just published a study on this subject, but like a lot of this research, it's preclinical, which means he wasn't studying humans yet. He was looking at cells. In contrast, there is clinical research on humans indicating that omega-3s may be good for your heart.
Certainly for things like atherosclerosis and coronary artery disease, and I want to point out preventative effects. A lot of people think that if I eat something, it's going to treat it. And basically what we're finding, particularly with omega-3 fatty acids, is you take it as a treatment modality. It may or may not work out for cardiovascular disease. It's a very debated topic. But there are some very clear-cut benefits, and the best described one is triglycerides.
That's free fat floating around in your blood. Bad for your heart, and omega-3s lower it. But not all omega-3s are alike. The long-chain ones that we're talking about right now come from oily fish like salmon. The short-chain ones that come from, say, walnuts are probably beneficial too, but not for circulating fat. Now, your body can make the long-chain ones from the short-chain ones, but not very efficiently.
So if you don't eat fish, consume it as a supplement. And you can, you know, purchase them as supplements, or if you have elevated triglycerides, your physician may prescribe them for you.
Then there's the case of omega-6 fatty acids that come from things like vegetable oil. These can be good for you too, but they also provide an example of why it's dangerous to boil this stuff down to good fats versus bad fats.
Certain populations metabolize fat differently. So African Americans compared to Americans of European ancestry. African Americans, for a variety of reasons, are more prone to a lot of diseases. Not all, but I'm talking about metabolic obesity kind of diseases.
And one reason for that may be that African Americans appear to metabolize omega-6s differently. They might not be able to derive the same benefits from this that, say, I can.
So maybe those are the people that need to be eating more omega-3s. And that verdict isn't out yet. It's just a hypothesis right now. But it's plausible, and there are data that are suggesting that that's true.
So far, we've been talking about polyunsaturated fats. Let's talk about monounsaturated fats, the big example in my cooking, at least, being olive oil. Ha!
Clearly, increasing your consumption of olive oil has potential benefits.
Yeah, it does. Chief among those benefits being deliciousness, but there's also evidence that it may reduce blood pressure and LDL or bad cholesterol. So yay, olive oil. Yay, olive oil. Now we come to the big controversy du jour, saturated fats. These are the fats that are solid at room temperature and generally come from animal sources like meat and dairy.
Saturated fat raises LDL, your quote-unquote bad cholesterol. And so that contributes toward atherosclerosis. There's controversy around that because there's studies out there that have shown potential you know, requirements for saturated fats, and there may be benefits for some of these saturated fats. And again, it boils down to what type of saturated fat.
There's some research indicating that saturated fats from coconuts may be better for you than fats from dairy, like butter and cream, which may in turn be better for you than fats from meat. But in Dr. Shaikh's opinion, the jury is still out on all of that, and it depends who you are.
If you're somebody that's got heart disease, that has elevated triglycerides, that is high, you know, what's known as HbA1c, glycosylated hemoglobin, you're a diabetic, maybe it's not good for you. Or if you're a 12-year-old kid who's growing, your needs are different.
Take me, for example. I've got a certified case of dad bod. I'd love to be a little bit leaner, but my cholesterol and blood pressure are, like, perfect. So I tend to try to avoid saturated fats purely as a means of watching my total calories, and also making room for better fats like olive oil. Ha! For all the good and bad things you can say about fats, they are the most calorie-dense macronutrient by far, and you have to take that into consideration. That said, there is plenty of evidence that even though carbs have fewer calories, simple carbs like sugar and white flour might make you fatter than fats because they mess with your blood sugar and the hormones that regulate nutrient absorption and appetite. I don't know if I take in too much fat, but I definitely take in too much sugar. And alcohol. Alcohol has calories too. Last thing to say in defense of fats is to point out that they are essential nutrients. Your body uses them for all kinds of functions necessary to keeping you alive. And they're necessary for your body to absorb other essential nutrients, namely vitamins A, D, E, and K, the fat-soluble vitamins. So does that mean you have to eat a bunch of fat in every meal in order to absorb all of the vitamins you're eating in that particular sitting? As I understand it, that's still in question, but there's plenty of evidence that it helps. Research out of Iowa, for example, has been looking at the effects of oily salad dressing on nutrient absorption, and they found a very strong correlation. The more dressing, the more vitamins people were able to absorb out of their salads. There is one form of fat that you probably shouldn't ever eat, and that's artificial trans fats. These are oils that have been modified to be solid at room temperature and have a really long shelf life. Until recently, these were everywhere in processed foods.
At a very molecular level, they have effects on membranes and effect on structural effects. But trans fats in general contribute toward, you know, heart disease, and that's become very well accepted. And so, as you can see with food policy, that trans fats have been cut out.
And one place where you or I might still encounter artificial trans fats in the kitchen is in shortening. Now, where that leaves shortening and the intimately intertwined discipline of Southern-style biscuit making is a topic that we'll take on next week.